If you've been doing some classical mechanics, you've probably found out that there's more than one way to get to the right answer. What's going on with that, and how can we understand it using the Lagrangian? Before starting, I'd just like to thank this guy. I'd say his name, but I can't pronounce it. I don't want to mispronounce it. I found him on YouTube. I'm basically copying his stuff, so now that I've appeased my conscience, let's begin. Most textbooks and introductory classes that deal with mechanics deal with the kinematic equations first. Here's three of them. And then you go on to mechanics, the big equation, Newton's second law, net force equals mass times acceleration. And then you start talking about energy, kinetic energy and gravitational potential energy. And you can use things like that to solve problems like this. A ball is falling from a height of 12 meters. Tell me about it. Tell me how long it takes to hit the ground and what speed it's going when it hits the ground. So you write down some information about the problem, and then you go to the kinematic equations and you solve them, and everybody's happy. Everybody's happy. That's great. Then you can take a look at the same situation using a free body diagram. You can talk about the forces, the one force acting on this ball. Net force equals mass times acceleration, and there you go, and we're good again. Acceleration is equal to g, 9.8 meters per second squared down. Then you can integrate. Integrate acceleration to get velocity, integrate velocity, integrate again to get position. And there you go. Only we're not so happy about this notation. That notation is what we'll use. X for position, x dot for velocity, x double dot for acceleration. X dot is just the time derivative of x. X double dot, this is Newton's notation for calculus. And there you go. And this gives us all the information we could want about this ball as it falls. Where is it? And how fast is it going? Ask that question at any time and we can tell you an answer and we can solve this problem. But can we solve it another way? Looking at energy. We're looking at gravitational potential energy here is being converted to kinetic energy. So what's up with that? Well, we get the same answer for the final velocity after falling those 12 meters, which makes us feel good, but not totally good. Because although we can get the final velocity after falling 12 meters, can we get graphs like this? The answer is the Lagrangian. Lagrangian can do this. What is the Lagrangian? Well, the Lagrangian looks pretty simple. It looks complicated if you look at it in some textbooks, but it looks pretty innocuous with this equation there, just kinetic energy minus potential energy, or a lot of times instead of K minus U, it's T minus V in many textbooks, but this is not many textbooks. This is my presentation, so we'll use K and U, and the Lagrangian fits in Lagrange's equation, which is not as bad as it looks. Trust me, we'll go through several examples. Hey, look, an X dot. That's neat. And we can use Lagrange's equation to tackle this falling ball, but enough about those initial conditions. We don't need just initial conditions for one particular problem. We can describe everything you'd ever want to know about this falling ball using the Lagrangian, and as promised, it is kinetic energy minus potential energy. So let's take some partial derivatives, which aren't as bad as they sound. Trust me, the partial L with respect to X is just minus mg. See that? Good. The partial L with respect to X dot is just mx dot. And then take the time derivative of that, mx double dot. And then put the terms together, and there you have it. And oh dear, we have an issue with a negative sign. What's going on here? Well, last time we used down as the positive direction, but this time, because of the whole potential energy thing, we kind of have to use up as the positive direction. So just stay calm about that negative issue there. Acceleration is equal to 9.8 meters per second squared down, and everybody's happy. How about a slightly more complicated situation? The Atwood machine, or the half Atwood machine. You've probably analyzed a system like this perhaps in a mechanics class, but have you done so with the Lagrangian? Now's your chance. First step is to write out the Lagrangian. Not too complicated here. Kinetic energy of the car, kinetic energy of the falling weight. That's good. Then we have the gravitational potential energy of m2. No change in gravitational potential energy for the car. Let's take some partial derivatives. Partial dl dx. Okay, partial dl dx prime, and then the time derivative, and then put them together and see what you have. Well, you see what you have here. You have net force is equal to mass times acceleration. Let's take a big picture. a satellite going around the sun or a satellite going around a planet. This is good. It's the same situation with the Lagrangian kinetic energy minus potential energy. And the gravitational potential energy looks a little bit different now, but I hope you've seen that before. Next, the partial L with respect to X. Very good. Hold on a second. Let's take a closer look at this derivative here. Not too bad. That 1 over x, that's just x to the negative 1. So it's the same sort of power rule that we've been using before. Negative and a negative, so it's positive. Negative 2. Okay, I'm good. And then dl dx prime and a time derivative and put them together. And there you go. Acceleration is equal to big G times the big mass divided by x squared. And you might know if you plug in Newton's universal gravitational constant, the mass of the Earth, and the radius of the Earth, you'll get 9.8 meters per second squared. Good for us. And you might have noticed at this point that our first step has always given us force. We haven't really had to talk about force, but our first step has given us force. Partial dl dx gives us negative du dx, which gives us force, and that's not surprising if you remember that work is equal to the integral of f dx, and work is defined, work network done on a system is defined as the change in kinetic energy. And you notice that we're talking about conservative forces here. All these forces are conservative. So if you're waiting for me to talk about sliding a box along the surface with your hand and pushing on it and having friction act on it, then that's just not going to happen, because that sort of friction force, that would be a non-conservative force, a path-dependent force. Let's back up here and then shake things around a little bit. Oh no, simple harmonic motion. This should get interesting, and it will. The Lagrangian gives us the kinetic energy minus the potential energy, and we're good with that. Next, the partial derivative dl dx gives us negative kx again. That's the force, negative kx, where x is the displacement. That gives the force. The other side of the equation, partial dl dx prime gives us, well, we've seen this several times before, and we can put them together, and notice what we have. We have a, or x double prime, is equal to negative k over m times x. Now, what type of function would be so crazy as to be proportional to the opposite of its own second derivative with respect to time? And if you're thinking the cosine function, I'm thinking you might have seen this before, but here we have cosine, and the derivative of that is the negative sine, and the derivative of that is the negative cosine, and we're doing good. Now plug x double dot. See, we have an equation for that. Plug x double dot in there and x in there, and that's what we get. A little bit of rearranging gives us omega is equal to root k over m. What's omega? In this case, it's the angular frequency of the system. The system is oscillating back and forth and back and forth, and the angular frequency is equal to 2 pi times the frequency of the system. A little bit of rearranging there gives us an expression for the period of this spring mass system. And if you had fun with the spring mass system, you're going to love the pendulum. We're going to love the pendulum because we get a chance now to deal not with x's and x dots, but thetas and theta dots. Same story, different look to it, but it's the same story. I just like going rotational every now and again. It's fun, and we have an h here. How can we express h in terms of theta? That's how. That's a little bit complicated. We're staying with it, though. Plugging that into our Lagrangian. Expanding with the parentheses, making it easier to differentiate. We'll be doing that in a second. We'll be doing that now. Doing that now and here. And you might recognize that as the force, the net force acting on the pendulum ball there as it's moved to that angle. And then on the other side of the equation, partial L with respect to theta dot, and then the time derivative, and then the moment of inertia of the particle is ML squared. Doing good. And we're only good, though, for small angles, which means we can use the small angle approximation where sine theta is approximately equal to theta. But we're good. We've got that same situation there where this guy finds himself or herself proportional to the negative of their second time derivative, and that means it's a sine or a cosine type thing. That means we have trigonometric functions. That means we have an angular frequency and an equation for the period of the system. Who's ready to do one more? One more? All right. Let's roll down the ramp here. We're rolling down the ramp, and here we have a disc, not a ball this time, but a solid disc rolling down a ramp. Hopefully you've seen something like this before. We're going to start out with rotational mechanics. Instead of Fnet equals Ma, we have tau equals I alpha. Alpha, of course, is equal to A over R. Again, this is only for people who have seen these sorts of things before. If this is the first time you've ever seen a problem like this, you're like, what is that guy talking about? Anyway, tau is equal to force times the radial arm, so that's friction, times R is equal to, I said it was a disc, 1/2 mr squared times A over R. Hey, look, an expression for friction. I know what I can do with that. We can plug that expression for friction into our linear mechanics statement. Net force is equal to mass times acceleration. What's the net force? It's mg sine beta minus friction. And a little bit of rearranging, you can find acceleration. Acceleration positive if you're talking about going down the ramp. We're going to use a negative 2/3 g sine beta, though, because when we're doing the Lagrangian, we'll measure x going up the ramp, which is easier to think about when you're calculating the potential energy. Hey, look, we have to worry not just about linear kinetic energy, but rotational kinetic energy also. And there's a gravitational potential energy term there. Again, finding H is the issue. Finding H, not too bad in this case, but it is bad because now we're mixing X dots and theta dots. Can't do that. Don't have to, though. We can rearrange with some definitions. That's pretty ugly, but it cleans up nice. It really does clean up nice. Rotational motion cleans up nice. And now we can take some partial derivatives. It's been a couple minutes, and we are taking partial derivatives. dl dx gives you negative mg sine beta. Wait, don't we have to take the derivative of that sine beta? No, beta is a constant. Sine beta is a constant. We don't have to take the derivative of that, but I'm glad that you were thinking about that. Shows you're paying attention. dl dx dot gives you this, that, and the other thing. And hey, look, it's the 2/3 g sine beta that we promised ourselves, and we have it for a disc rolling down a ramp, for a pendulum bob going back and forth and back and forth, or a mass on a spring doing the same sort of dance, or a satellite in orbit. Hey, that's the same sort of dance, isn't it, too? Or a Atwood machine, a car accelerating across a table, or a ball falling down. We can describe these types of motion using the Lagrangian and not worrying about forces. Look at that. L is equal to K minus U. No worrying about forces here, which is kind of handy if you're talking about quantum mechanics. And that's not what we're going to talk about in part.